Hello, welcome to my talk, all about the fluids. This talk is the first part of turbulence models on zero equation turbulence models. Although the zero equation turbulence models might be phased out practically in research and applications, the introduction of the zero equation models is still very useful in both providing a complete picture in the turbulence modeling and enhancing the understandings why the zero equation turbulence models in some flows could be same successful as or even better than the 1 and the 2 equation turbulence models. This would surely help us to understand the turbulence modeling better. The motivation for this talk is zero equation turbulence models have already phased out in the modern turbulence modeling, and it is not an option anymore in ANSYS Fluent nor in the NASA Langley Research Center turbulence modeling resources. You can find this in the website. Here, this is the website link. Zero equation turbulence models have been quite successful in the early development of the turbulence models, and some of them could give better predictions than those 1 and 2 equation turbulence models. It would be useful to introduce and to analyze the zero equation turbulence models, especially when trying to understand the turbulence models better and hope to establish new turbulence model. It should be noted, advanced turbulence models would be still prevailing in the practical applications. Although the hybrid lens LES model may be the main driving force in the research of turbulent flows. In this talk, I will present Prandtl's mixed lens hypothesis. The modern form of the mixing lens models and zero equation turbulence models. The half equation turbulence models. The algebraic Reynolds stress models. This talk is mainly based on the reference Will Cox's book, Turbulence Modeling for CFD, together with some other references were cited. Based on the analysis of the molecular shear stress in fluid, especially in an ideal gas, we could determine tau xy in terms of the mean velocity uy and the fluid kinematic viscosity nu, based on the following assumptions. For a perfect gas, molecular velocity follows the Maxwellian distribution so that all directions are supposed to be equal at the so-called thermal velocity, uth, which would be roughly 4/3 of the speed of sound for air. On average, half of the molecules move in positive y direction, while the other half moving downward. Hence, the average vertical speed is half uth, and the mean free path is lmfp. The average number of molecules moving across the unit area in the positive y direction is n uth divided by 4. Here n is the number of the molecular per unit volume. Based on the assumption, the analysis of the molecular shear stress in fluids would be given by tau xy equals nu times the gradient of u with regard to y. The molecular viscosity is given by this formula. Here UTH is the average molecular velocity, or the thermal velocity. LMFP is the mean free path. Prandtl proposed a simplified model for the turbulence motion, in which he assumed the fluid particles moves in lumps, the fluid units. The lumps maintain their momentum in x direction for a vertical distance, L mix, the mixing length. In analogy, Prandtl could replace the fluid molecules with the fluid lumps by replacing the mean free path LMFP using L mix, together with the mixing velocity U mix, to replacing the thermal velocity UTH. Therefore, the shear stress tau xy is given by this formula. Prandtl further assume the mixing velocity can be given by this U mix equals 2 L mix times the absolute of the capital U gradient with regard to y. Here, the factor 2 is used for canceling out the factor 1 over 2 in here. This would lead to the Prandtl's mixing length hypothesis as tau xy equals 2 nu t times capital U gradient with regard to y. And here, the kinematic ad viscosity is given by this equation. So it should be noted the mixing length model is incomplete, since the mixing length L mix needs to be specified in the actual simulation. In this slide, the mixing length theory is applied for the free shear in compressible flows, include far wick, mixing layer, plane and round jet, constant radial jet. All these free shear flows have the common features. The flows far downstream would be independent of the details of the geometry and the flow condition near x equals to 0. All the flow have the constant pressure, and the fluid velocity distributions could have a general form expressed as this. Here, capital U xy is the velocity distribution, and U0 is the velocity at y equals to 0. This f function is a function of the ratio of y divided by the waves, delta x, the spreading or weak waves. For all these flows, the velocity profiles located at different x stations could have the similar shape when plotted in the scaled form as the ratio of the velocity distribution capital UXY over the velocity U0 at y equals 0 versus the ratio of the y over the spreading waves, or given by the direct velocity distribution divided by U0X versus the ratio of y over the wake waves. The flow with such properties are called self-preserving or self-similarity. So from the analysis, all these five shear flows are two-dimensional or extra symmetric flows with the constant pressures, and they should not be affected too much by the boundary layer. Therefore, the Navier-Stokes equation would be given in a general form as this. The first equation is from the continuity equation, and the second equation is from the moment equation. And here, the indices M and J might be different for different flows. For the Fahwick mixing layer and the Prandtl, M and J are all zero. For the round jet, M is zero and J is one. And for the constrained radial jet, M equals to one and J is zero. And the mixing lens has a general form as this. Here, alpha is the closure coefficient. However, alpha is a constant for each specific flows, but for the five different shear flows, alpha would be different. See here, the value alpha is fine-tuned using the corresponding experiment data. So once the mixing lens is fine-tuned, and the prediction of the mixing lens theory would be very good. For example, for the Fahwick, we can see the expression is very close to the experiment data. And for the mixing layer, again, we can see the prediction from the mixing lens theory is very close to the experiment data. In the previous examples for the free shear flows, we have shown that the mixing lens is a constant across the layer and proportional to the width of the layer given by this formula. However, in many practical problems, the turbulent flows are subject to the boundaries. Therefore, the boundary layer would be very important for the turbulent flows. This figure shows the conventional profile of the boundary layer. Basically, there are three regions: the viscous sublayer, the local layer, as well as the defect layer. This is a conventional figure in many textbooks. However, the author found it is confusing for the layer definition. In Newman's book Marine Hydrodynamics, the defect law is shown to be varied within the boundary layer from 0.01 to 0.15 of the boundary layer thickness. The defect law is given by this formula. It seems to the author the defect law is not in the outer boundary of the boundary layer. So this is a confusing issue, and the author will continue to examine the issue in the future. But in this talk, this different definition for the boundary layer region is not an important issue. So for an incompressible and zero gradient pressure boundary layer, the sum of the viscous and the Reynolds shear stress can be supposed to be a constant. And using the mixing lens model, we have a relation as this, and the U-tau here is the friction velocity. So based on the Prandtl's original postulation for the flow near the solid boundaries, the mixing lens is proportional to the distance from the surface, given as this. Here, kappa equals 0.41 is the one common constant, but sometimes kappa is also given by 0.4. So based on the above equations, we can easily obtain the expression as this, u plus and the y plus, the relation. So this is the expression for the log layer. And the non-dimensional u plus is defined as this, and the non-dimensional y plus is defined as this. Therefore, this is a very simple derivation for the expression of the conventional turbulent boundary layer. Since this is the same as this, if C equals to 5.1. So we can see from the previous slide, the simple relation of the mixing length model that is proportional to the distance from the wall boundaries may be valid for the logarithmic law only for the outer part of the boundary layer. And it is found that this simple mixing length model could lead to the difficulties in predicting the skin flexion in practical applications. Therefore, the modified mixing length model have been proposed, including when dressed in 1956. So the mixing length is modified by this. Here, the A plus 0 equals 26. And if we plot out the function in the square bracket, so the modification of the mixing length is only for the small y plus. We can see the modification is significant when y plus is smaller than 100. In 1956, Clouseau formulated the kinetic eddy viscosity in the outer part of the boundary as this. So here, delta star is the displacement thickness, and UE is the velocity at the edge of the layer, and alpha is the closure coefficient. And SQD in 1966, by limiting the peak value of the maximum length, so for improving predicting accuracy by this formula. Cossing and Kistler in 1954 and Klapnov in 1954. So in the intermittent region, the eddy viscosity should be modified by timing the following function, the Klapnov function, by this. And this modification can be drawn out as this. So the Klapnov function, it's a modification for the eddy viscosity in the out boundaries. When y is larger than 0.4, the boundary layer thickness.